All right, so I'm going to start with definite integrals. So last time when we had discussed definite integrals, we mostly talked about Leibniz rule and inequality properties. Okay, however, that is not the end of the properties. Unfortunately, there are a few more to be done. So I'm slightly doubtful whether we'll be able to start vectors today. Okay, so let's see. I'll try my best to start. So meanwhile, let me start with this property. Okay, I don't remember the property number actually. So let's look into this property. This property says that if f of t is an odd function, if f of t is an odd function, okay, then an integral function like phi x, which is defined as integral from a to x f of t dt. Okay, here a is some constant. Okay, here a is some constant. A is a constant here. Then this function is an even function. So this integral function that you see here, this integral function, I am just putting it under a box. This integral function will be a even function. That is what this property says. Okay. Can we quickly prove this? The proof for this is very easy. Let's try to prove this. Now, if you want to show that any function is even function, what do you actually do? What do you actually do? You actually replace your x with a minus x, correct? And you try to see whether the function gives itself back or not. That means is, we are trying to inquire whether is phi of minus x is equal to phi of x or not. Because if it is, then only we can prove it's an even function. Correct? Okay, so if you have to change your x with a minus x in this, you are replacing the sign of x with a minus x, isn't it? Okay, now let us use some properties to figure out whether this is giving me the same phi of x function back or not. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this as a to minus a f of t and minus a to minus x f of t. Okay, so what I did, I just broke the limits of integration, which was from a to minus x at minus a. So the first integral is a to minus a f of t dt, and the second integral is minus a to minus x f of t dt. Okay, now since f of t is an odd function, since f of t is an odd function, can I say a to minus a or minus a to a f of t will ultimately become a zero? Remember the even odd property. So please recall the even odd property which we had done. This property said that if you are integrating any odd function from minus a to a or a to minus a, doesn't matter, the result would be zero. Correct? So this term over here goes to zero, right? So what are we left with ultimately? We are left with minus a to minus x f of t dt. Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just make an interim change of the variable name. So let me put t as minus y. Okay, so this implies dt is negative dy. Dt is equal to negative dy. So if you make this change over here, it becomes f of minus y and dt is negative dy. What about the limits of integration? Can I say limit of integration will now become from a to x? Because the moment you put t as minus a, y will be a. And the moment you put t as minus x, y will be x. Now, given that it's an odd function, can I say f of minus y is minus f of y? Because f of x is an odd function. Correct? So can I write this as negative a to x, negative f of y dy? Negative negative will go off and it becomes a to x f of y dy. And we know there is nothing in the name. I can put it back to t. It doesn't matter. And you can see that you are back to the same function phi of x. Okay. So we started with phi of minus x, as you can see here. And we ended the proof at phi of x, right? Which clearly implies that phi of x is an even function. Please note that here this a could be zero also. It doesn't matter whether we have a as zero or a non-zero quantity. This relation will always be true. So if you are integrating any odd function from a to x, where a can be any quantity, zero, non-zero, doesn't matter, it will always result into an even function. It will always result into an even function. Let's take a quick question on this. Just one question is sufficient for this concept. So if you have a function which is 0 to x log of 1 minus t by 1 plus t dt, okay, then f of x is option A, an odd function. Option B, an even function. Option C, neither even nor odd. Option D, data insufficient. How will you solve this? Good afternoon, Likhit, Paras, and my dear friend Aditya is missing. How was the exam, Paras? Paras, Likhit, how was the exam? You can unmute and talk to me. How was the paper?
Good, sir.
Good. How good? 90 plus?
That I don't know.
Okay. At least you just did justice to your preparation, right? Okay. Shreya says even. This problem is a very simple problem. It's actually a 1 second problem. Okay. So if you see this function, this is your f of t, correct? Right? And it's clear that f of t, if you replace your t with a minus t, it will become log 1 plus t by 1 minus t, which is nothing but negative log 1 minus t by 1 plus t. And isn't this negative of f of t? Correct? Which means f of t is an odd function. Okay. An integral of an odd function from a to x, a can be zero, non-zero, doesn't matter. This will always result into, this answer will always be a, sorry, this result will always be a even function. So f of x, I should not call it as f because f was already used. I'm sorry for using the same name. Let's use some other name, g, let's say. So g of f of t in this case, g of t in this case is an odd function. So f of x is an even function. So option number B is correct. Is that fine? Easy one. Now you don't have to sit and evaluate this limit. Okay. You don't have to sit and evaluate this integral. Okay. Without evaluating this integral, you can use this property to reach to your answer directly. You know, 90% of the people who don't know this property would sit and evaluate this and then figure out whether the integral is an even function or odd function, right? This saves a lot of time if you can use this function. So we'll move on to the twin of this property, which says that if f of t is an even function, if f of t is an even function, then an integral function like this. Why I'm calling it as an integral function? Because this function is dependent on an integral. So you're evaluating an integral. Integral from 0 to x, my dear, not a to x this time. This will always be an odd function. So the difference in the previous property and this property is that in the previous property, you had f of t as an odd function and your integral function was from a to x f of t. And that answer was a even function. Here, f of t is an even function and integral of that from 0 to x is an odd function. That is the difference. So please appreciate this difference. Okay. Now, here, please note that if you are claiming your phi of x, that is a to x f of t, is an odd function, then please remember your integral from 0 to a must be 0. This must not exist. Because if this exists, then this may not be an odd function. See, I'm moving my cursor. This may not be an odd function if this condition is not satisfied. Are you getting my point? So please remember this also. So normally, if f of t is an even function, then 0 to x f of t dt will be an odd function. But if you are claiming that a to x f of t is an odd function, then remember 0 to a f of t dt must give you 0. Else it will not be an odd function. Am I clear? Am I clear on this statement? Please type CLR on your chat box if this sounds okay to you.
Clear, sir.
Clear. Oh, Aditya is here. Hi, Aditya. How was the paper?
It was good, sir.
Good, sir. You don't sound like that.
It was like good enough.
Okay. I know you all guys are tired after 3 hours of paper and then again 3 hours of class. But this is how class 12 goes.
No, sir. I was like taking a power nap, so I just now woke up.
Okay. Now you're powerful enough. Okay, so let me prove this. Let me prove this first. The proof is very simple. So if you want to prove that your phi of x is an odd function, basically we need to prove that phi of minus x is minus of phi x. Correct? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So phi of minus x would be what? Phi of minus x would be 0 to minus x f of t dt. Now very simple, let t be minus y. Just once again. Yeah. So if t is minus y, dt would be negative dy. Correct. So f of negative y and dt is negative dy from limit of integration will now be 0 to x. Getting the point? Now, f of minus y is negative f of y because f of x is an odd function. I'm sorry, by the way, it's an even function, right? So this will, f of x is an even function. Correct? So I can write this as negative 0 to x f of y dy itself. So I'm just replacing f of minus y with f of y. Now there's nothing in the name. I can just put the y back as t. Correct? And this is nothing but negative of phi x. Isn't it? Which clearly implies that phi of negative x is negative of phi x, which implies phi of x is an odd function. Is that clear? Any doubt? Yes, sir. Okay. So guys, next we are going to talk about some improper integrals. I'm not going to take any question on this because the concept per se is clear to you through the previous example. So all of you, please be very attentive in the next half an hour of this session where I'm going to talk about improper integrals. Okay. This concept is basically a slightly above JEE main level. Okay. But normally when questions come on this, people are clueless how to go about it. So I'm going to give you some tips and tricks how to solve it. Many a time these questions are asked in JEE advanced exams. Okay. But if you know these tricks fully, it will make your life better. Okay. So I'm going to introduce to you two improper integrals today. One is called the gamma function. And second is called the beta function. They both are related. Okay. So if you know one properly, other could be expressed in terms of the other. Okay. Now, let me start with gamma function. These are two special improper integrals. It's not like these two only make the improper integrals. What is improper integral? Improper integral is where one of your limits is either infinity or minus infinity, like that. For example, if I say something like this, integration from 0 to infinity, okay, of any function. Since your upper limit is infinity, right, both the limits can also be infinity or minus infinity. For example, something like this, okay. These are typical examples of improper integrals where you don't have a finite value of either the upper or the lower limit. Okay. Now, these two are of special mention. It's not like all improper integrals come under gamma and beta functions. These two functions are some special type of improper integrals. And why I'm dealing with this is because there is a special formula which is coming up in this today's class, which is called the Wallace formula, which is based on this. So it is important to know a bit of their, you know, preview so that we understand that formula very well. Now, what is a gamma function? So let's say gamma function, let's say n is a positive integer. So n is a positive number, not integer. Okay. Then an improper integral of this type, 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power n minus 1. Okay. This is called gamma n. The symbol is like this. Symbol is just like a square root symbol. So gamma n is this integral. Okay. This integral is given a special name, and that name is gamma function. Okay. So x here are all, x should be from positive. X should be all positive rational numbers here. Okay. Now, of course, we don't have to evaluate this for all values of n. So some special values you should know. For example, you should know what is the value of gamma 1. I would request you all to tell me what is gamma 1. I'm sure you can tell me. gamma 1 means what? You are integrating it from 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power 1 minus 1. This is gamma 1, which is 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power 0. Which is 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x. I'm sure you can evaluate this. What is it? E to the power minus x minus 1. Right? What happens when you put infinity in place of x over here? Who will tell me what is e to the power minus x as x tends to infinity?
It tends to 0.
It tends to 0, absolutely. Because it is as good as saying 1 by e to the power x. Right? So any number whose modulus is less than 1 raised to an infinitely big power will end up giving you 0. Okay? So that's why this answer is 0. So it will become 0 minus minus e to the power 0. That's going to be 1. So gamma 1 is 1. No doubt about it? Okay, tell me what is gamma 2?
So I got it as e to the power minus x into 1 minus x.
No, no, no. Your answer will never be in terms of x because you are doing a definite integral, right? Your answer will always be a number. See, it is 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x, x to the power 2 minus 1. 2 minus 1 is 1 only, right? So ultimately you are integrating this. Okay. So what rule will you use to integrate this? Integration by parts. You'll use IBP here. Correct, Aditya? So if you integrate it by parts, yes, you can choose this as your first function, choose this as your second function. So x into integration of this is minus e to the power minus x, minus derivative of x is 1. And integration of this is again minus e to the power minus x, so which is nothing but minus x e to the power minus x minus e to the power minus x from 0 to infinity. When you put an infinity, okay, now here is a call that we need to take. Here is something which is infinity to the power tending to 0. Okay, so let me write it like this. Let me write it as minus x e to the power minus x limit x tending to infinity. Okay, this would anyways become a 0. Okay, let me just make it equal to, okay, minus, when you put a 0, this becomes 0 and this becomes minus of 1. Okay, so this will become minus x e to the power minus x limit x tending to infinity and this will become plus 1. Okay, let's evaluate this. To evaluate this, we can use L'Hopital's rule. Sorry. Okay, so use L'Hopital's rule. So differentiate it, it becomes 1. This becomes e to the power x, limit x tending to infinity. Now, as x tends to infinity, this will become a super large number. So 1 by a super large number will give you everything as 0 over here. So answer is again a 1. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Hamsini, is it clear? Great. Now, I don't want you to evaluate a little further. I just want you to find gamma 3. That's it. Then I'll tell you a basic pattern that these gamma functions follow. Gamma 3, you would realize that your answer will come out to be 2. Let's check.
Yes, sir.
Okay, by the way, in order to do integration by parts, you can use DI method over here. Do you remember DI method? Who doesn't remember DI method? Tic-tac-toe method, DI method. Do you remember we had done that? Okay, I'll do it over here. So gamma 3, which is 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x square. So if you want to apply integration by parts over here, take this as u, take this as v. And then we follow the DI method. In the DI method, we write the v function under I, u function under d. So keep differentiating it till you get a zero. Keep integrating it. So minus e to the power minus x, again e to the power minus x, again minus e to the power minus x. Put an alternating plus minus plus sign here, plus minus plus minus. Okay. Then start multiplying this crosswise. Okay. So your answer for this will be minus x square e to the power minus x. Okay. This will be minus 2x e to the power minus x. Again, minus 2 e to the power minus x. Okay, from 0 to infinity. Now, let me tell you that when you put infinity, everything here will become a 0. You can try out taking the limit also. Okay. And when you try putting a 0, you will get this 0, and you get a minus 2 over here. So that answer will actually give you a 2. Correct? Now, time to know some properties which will make your life very easy. So I'll write this as properties of gamma function. Properties of gamma function. The first property that you basically would observe from whatever we have done so far is gamma n is basically nothing but n minus 1 factorial. Okay. If n happens to be a natural number. Okay. This is something which you will observe through pattern when you do a lot of, let's say you found gamma 3, gamma 4, gamma 5. You realize that this is the property which it follows. Right. Many books will write it as gamma n plus 1 is equal to n factorial. Both are the same thing. You're just replacing your n with n plus 1. Correct? So if somebody says, what is the integral of, let me give an example. Integral of 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power 5, let's say. Right? What is the answer for this? The moment you realize, oh, this is nothing but gamma 6. Isn't it? Please remember this term is your n minus 1 term. So n is your 6. So it's gamma 6. Gamma 6 will be 5 factorial, which is 120. Right? So this is a property which is very important. Next property which is important is gamma n plus 1 actually follows a recursive relation, which is n gamma n. I think we can easily prove this. Anybody who wants to try the proving of this, prove that gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n. That means, prove that 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n is n times 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n minus 1.
So the factorial thing itself.
No, factorial thing actually has come from this property. This is the father of this property.
Okay.
So we cannot prove the father from the child property. Very easy. Just let me know once you're done with the trying. Integration by parts is the key for this. Hint. Just type done on your chat box once you're done so that I can discuss it. Done, anyone? Okay, gamma n plus 1 is 0 to infinity e to the power minus x, x to the power n dx. Okay, take this as your first function, take this as your second function. Correct? So x to the power n, okay, integral of this is e to the power minus x with a minus sign, okay, from 0 to infinity minus. Derivative of x to the power n is n x to the power n minus 1. Integral of e to the power minus x is e to the power minus x with a plus sign. Okay. 0 to infinity. Okay. Now, minus x to the power n by e to the power x from 0 to infinity. This anyways is n gamma n. Correct? You just pull this n out. Okay. And the remaining term is gamma n. Isn't it? Now here, exponential function, as let's evaluate this as limit n tends to limit x tends to infinity. So what is the answer for this? Okay, minus, anyways, it's going to be zero when you put a zero. Okay. What is this term? This term has a polynomial by an exponential. Now remember, when x is going towards infinity, exponential grows faster than a polynomial function. It grows much faster than a polynomial function. Okay. Therefore, this result would have a very high, heavier base as compared to the numerator. So this term will become a zero term, leaving you with n gamma n. Okay. So therefore, we can say gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n. Is that fine? Next property, property number 3 is very important expression is this gamma half. Gamma half is root pi. Gamma half is root pi. Now, the proof for this I will not share with you because it involves undergrad concept, which involves the use of Jacobians and all. Okay, so I'll not be talking about the proof for this. But knowing this value is helpful because it can solve a lot of problems for us. Okay. It's a helpful result. So please just remember that gamma half is root of pi. Okay. Anybody who is interested in knowing this proof, okay, I'll send you the proof separately. So this proof involves converting Cartesian coordinates to polar coordinates and then using Jacobians to write a relationship between dx, dy in terms of the polar coordinates differential. Okay, so that's why I'm not talking about it, because there's so many things which you don't know right now. Next important thing that we need to know here is, how is this helpful in solving many types of problems? So we'll look at some illustrations on gamma function. By the way, this can come as a direct function, direct question also to you, because there's nothing that, except for the last property that we saw, there was nothing which was beyond your scope. Okay. Let's evaluate few things. Find 0 to infinity e to the power minus x x cube. I'm just giving you 10 seconds for this. Before the count of 10 is over, your answer should be there.
Sir, 24.
No.
Sorry. So six.
Yes. This is n minus 1, Aditya. Okay. N minus 1 is,
yes,
the
answer.
That means its answer will be gamma 4. Gamma 4 will be 3 factorial. Answer is 6. Okay. Good. Next question. Find 0 to 1 log of 1 by x to the power of 5 dx. Try this out. Now you must be wondering, how is it related to gamma function? Remember the last class, the last part of the class that we had discussed about how you can convert one integral to another by use of proper substitution. And there are a lot of hints in the question to know what substitution will work. For example, you have to convert this into something of the nature 0 to infinity kind of a thing, correct? So this integral has to be converted to such an integral. Okay, so you know that 0 and 1 by x, right? Somehow they will be helping you to get infinity. Log 1 is also helping you to get a 0. Anybody can suggest me what substitutions should I make here?
Log of that thing as something.
Right, very good. So Shreya is suggesting, let's substitute log 1 by x as t. Right, that means x is e to the power minus t dt. See, we also generated that exponential term which we desperately need in a gamma function. Correct? This term is what we require, correct? So dx is nothing. Oh, I'm sorry. Dx is nothing but minus e to the power minus t dt. Okay. So first of all, dx we can replace it with. Let me write once again. Integral minus e to the power minus t dt. And log of 1 by x is t. Correct? To the power of 5 here in this case. What about the limits of integration? Let's check out. When x is 0, you realize t has to go to infinity. Then only e to the power minus infinity will become a 0. Correct? And when x is 1, t has to be 0. Indirectly, if you swap the position of the upper and the lower limit and observe this minus sign, you end up getting something like this. And this term is nothing but what? Gamma?
6.
Gamma 6. And gamma 6 is what? 5 factorial. 5 factorial means 120. Do you see that? See, what I'm saying is, this is nothing which is beyond you. After this substitution, you would have anyways done integration by parts here, right? And that would have wasted a good amount of time for you. Let's say 2 to 3 minutes will go on doing integration by parts. Or let's say 2 minutes will go, isn't it? This made your life easy because you already know this type of function. Okay? So you save a lot of time. That's why I told you, knowing this will actually be like a tool for you to save time in your JEE exam. Okay. Next, we'll move on to the second of the improper integral, which we're talking about, that is beta function. Okay. Beta function written as bm, n. Okay. And it is defined as integral 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Here m and n are some positive numbers. Okay. Please note, if you make the substitution, if you make the use of King's property, if you use your King's property, the same expression, you can write it as 1 minus x to the power m minus 1 and 1 minus 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Okay. Which is nothing but 0 to 1, x to the power n minus 1, 1 minus x to the power m minus 1, isn't it? Which means that even if you swap the position of m and n, it doesn't make a difference to the result. Right? That is a very important property, that beta m comma n is same as beta n comma m. Okay. Now, a very interesting result here is that these two are not the only expressions for beta m comma n. So one expression we saw over here, another expression we saw over here. There's a third expression also. Okay. And that expression is, you can write your beta m comma n also as 0 to infinity x to the power m minus 1 by 1 plus x to the power m plus n. Now, let me ask you this as a question. Can you show that? Or can you show that? Or please prove that 0 to infinity x to the power m minus 1 by 1 plus x to the power m plus n is same as 0 to infinity x to the power n minus 1 by 1 plus x to the power m plus n and is equal to 0 to 1 x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1. Can you show that? While proving this is very easy because you already know that beta m comma n is same as beta n comma n. So replacing your n with m doesn't make a difference to the result. But what I'm interested more is, how do you prove this to this? How do you convert an improper to a proper looking function like this? Here your substitution skills is going to be tested. How good you are in substituting. Any idea? Look at the limits of integration. Those are very important identification or hints that you can actually use for your choice of the substitution. Anyone having any idea? If you're trying, please type trying.
Trying, sir.
Trying, okay. Okay, I think no movement has been seen so far with respect to this problem. Okay, so let me use here the substitution x is equal to 1 minus t by t. Now, this is in light of a lot of things. For example, I see 1 minus x also appearing. Secondly, as you can see that when you put your t as 0, x is infinity, and when you put your t as 1, correct, x is 0, correct? So in light of all these things, I have chosen this substitution. Let's see what happens. So first of all, what is dx? Let's find dx here. So dx would be nothing but minus 1 by t square dt. By the way, you can write this as 1 by t minus 1. So if we differentiate it, dx is equal to minus 1 by t square dt. Correct? Now let us substitute this in our given expression. So x to the power m minus 1 is like 1 by t to the power m minus 1. So m minus 1, t m minus 1 will come here. 1 plus x, what is 1 plus x? 1 plus x here is 1 by t. Correct? So you can write it as 1 by t to the power of m plus n. Correct? Dx is nothing but minus 1 by t square dt. So far, so good. What about limits of integration? When you put x as 0, when you put x as 0, t is 1. When you put x as infinity, t has to be 0. Any problem with respect to this? Now, if you simplify this, first of all, remove this minus sign and switch the position of the upper and the lower limit. Secondly, if this n goes up, it will become 1 minus t to the power of minus n minus 1 and t to the power 1 minus m dt by t square. Am I correct? Anything which I have missed out, please highlight. Oh, I'm so sorry. This will go up and become t to the power. This is 1 by t, by the way. Yeah, this is 1 by t. One second. So, a slight mistake here. Yeah, this will go up and become t to the power m plus n, 1 minus t to the power m minus 1 by t square, or you can say t square and t to the power m minus 1 will become m plus 1. Okay. Now again, adjusting the powers here, it will become 0 to 1 t to the power n minus 1 1 minus t to the power m minus 1 dt. Now there is nothing in the name, you can convert it back 0 to 1, x to the power n minus 1, 1 minus x to the power m minus 1. Okay. And you know your positions of m and n can be swapped. So if you swap the position of m and n, this becomes 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1 dx. Correct? Is this what we wanted to prove? If you check above over here, this is what, yes, this is what we wanted to prove. See here, this result and this result. Watch here, this result and this result, they are same. Okay. Now, this can be a potential question for you to convert one integral into the another. Now these JEE guys know that beta gamma function probably will not be used directly because that is not written in your syllabus. But they would frame a question involving these functions because it incorporates nothing but it's the use of proper substitution to convert one integral to another. That's why I took up this concept today. So that you are prepared even if such, you know, special functions are asked to you. What is most important now is the fact that there's a relationship between beta function and gamma function. And that relation is beta mn is actually gamma m gamma n by gamma m plus n. This is the most important property that we'll be using this in our Wallace formula. So gamma and beta functions, whatever we had studied, are related by this relation with each other. Okay. How this is useful? I will take up this after a small problem. So let's solve this question first. Integrate 0 to 1 x to the power 6 under root of 1 minus x square. Just try it out. How many of you are trying to solve this by the use of trigonometric substitutions? I mean, nothing wrong in doing that, but I just wanted to know how many of you substituted x as sine theta. Okay. Let me walk the talk. So how many of you did x equal to sine theta? That means dx is equal to cos theta d theta. Okay. So if you do that, it ends up giving you 0 to pi by 2 sine to the power 6 theta. This is going to become under root of 1 minus sine square, which is cos theta. And dx itself has a cos theta with it. So cos square theta d theta. Okay. Overall, this becomes the expression. Okay. Now, what do you do here? So here you have to use, since both of these powers are even, if you recall, we had done a similar case in indefinite integrals, right? Please turn your notes where I had discussed with you the type sine to the power mx, cos to the power nx, where m and n both are even integers, okay? So in that case, the approach was either use your complex number approach or you use your trigonometric identities. Now, both of these scenarios are going to make this a very long problem. Very long problem, isn't it? Yes or no? There should be a sad smiley here, but unfortunately, because there's no other smiley other than this guy. Okay. Yes, very long problem. Okay, so we would not even, you know, fathom to do it by this approach. On the other hand, let me show you how my beta and gamma functions are going to make my life super easy while solving such problems. Okay. So here what I'll do, all of you please see this carefully. I'm going to make a substitution. Let x square be t. That means 2x dx is equal to dt. So x dx is going to become dt by 2. So borrow 1x from here. So write it like this, 0 to 1, x to the power 5, under root 1 minus x square, x dx, and replace this x dx with dt by 2. Okay. So can I say limit of integration will not change? This will become t to the power 5 by 2. This will become 1 minus t to the power half. And there will be a dt by 2. Now try to compare this. Try to compare this with 0 to 1, x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1, which is actually the structure of beta m comma n, isn't it? So here m minus 1 is 5 by 2, and n minus 1 is half. So m is 7 by 2. And n is 3 by 2. So basically this thing is nothing but half beta 7 by 2, 3 by 2. And according to this relation, which I had discussed with you right now, according to this relation, very important relation, that's why I told this relation is very important. You can write this term as half gamma 7 by 2, gamma 3 by 2, by gamma 3 by 2, 7 by 2 will add up to give you a 5, isn't it? So please remember, I have just used this particular formula. So if you replace here 7 by 2 and here 3 by 2, it will become gamma 7 by 2, gamma 3 by 2 by gamma 7 by 2 plus 3 by 2, which is gamma 10 by 2, which is gamma 5. Okay. Now you must be wondering, how do I get these values? Fine, I got this expression, but how would I get their values? Now here, I would like you to take your attention to this property. Try to recall this property, which we had done a little while ago. Gamma n plus 1 is n gamma n. This is a very important property, the recursive property. So in light of that, can I write gamma 7 by 2 as 5 by 2 gamma 5 by 2? 5 by 2 gamma itself can be written as 3 by 2 gamma 3 by 2. And gamma 3 by 2 itself could be written as half gamma half. And gamma half is root pi, we just now discussed. Gamma half is root pi. So this is the value of the gamma 7 by 2 function, which is nothing but 15 by 8 root pi. Okay, similarly, you can evaluate others as well. Let me write down the final result. Half. This is nothing but 15 by 8 root pi. Okay. Gamma 3 by 2 is half root pi. Correct. And 5 factorial is 24. 5 factorial is 24. So ultimately, you'll see your answer is 15 into pi by 4 into 8 into 24. You can cancel out a factor of 3 from here. So it's 5 pi by 64 into 4. 64 into 4 is 256. This is your answer. This is much shorter than, please let me tell you, this is much shorter than you applying your trigonometric identities on that. Are you getting it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, something which is very associated with this result is, just now we talked about sine to the power 6, cos to the power 2 integration, right? So I'll tell you something very interesting. Just now we studied that gamma function, beta function is nothing but integration from 0 to 1 x to the power m minus 1, 1 minus x to the power n minus 1, correct? And we learned that this is gamma m gamma n by gamma m plus n, correct? Just now we learned this. Okay, now I'll show you something interesting. Let's say I put my x as sine square theta. I put my x as sine square theta. So can I say dx will be 2 sine theta cos theta d theta? Let me make this substitution over here. So this will become sine to the power of 2m minus 2. 1 minus sine square is cos square. So cos to the power 2n minus 2. Okay, and we have 2 sine theta cos theta. What will happen to the limit of integration? When x is 0, theta will also be 0. And when x is 1, theta is going to be pi by 2. Correct? Let me further simplify this. So this becomes sine to the 2 times sine to the power 2m minus 1 theta. Cos to the power 2n minus 1 theta. So this is given to us as gamma m gamma n by gamma m plus n. Bring this 2 down. If you bring this 2 down, we have a formula over here. Okay. Which is nothing but gamma m gamma n by 2 gamma m plus n. Okay. If you further want to refine it, that means put your 2m minus 1 as m dash and put your 2n minus 1 as n dash. That means your m is m dash plus 1 by 2 and n is n dash plus 1 by 2. And substitute this over here. You'd realize that you end up getting this. There's nothing in the name, so I can put back as m. So sine m theta cos n theta d theta is 2 times. Please replace your m with m dash plus 1 and m dash again with m. So this will become like this. Why did I put a 2 up? Sorry, 2 will be down. Sum of these two will be m plus n plus 2 by 2. Okay. So if m and n are integers over here, this formula is called as the Wallace formula. This formula is called as the Wallace formula. So wherever you see such kind of integral, you may directly jump to the use of Wallace formula. So please make a note of this. All of you, please make a note of this. Very important formula called as the Wallace formula. Note it down. Note it down. Let's have a question. Evaluate. Zero to pi by two. Sine to the power 4x, cos to the power 6x. Zero to pi by two, sine square x, cos to the power 3x. Zero to pi by two, sine to the power 5x, cos cube x. If you're done, just type 1 and write down the answer, or you can speak it out also. First one, pretty easy. This is your m, this is your n. So the answer will be what? Gamma m plus 1 by 2, which is 5 by 2. Gamma n plus 1 by 2, 7 by 2. By 2 gamma, just add these two. 5 by 2, 7 by 2 is going to be 6. Okay. Now gamma 5 by 2, again, just write it pretty quickly. 3 by 2 into half into root pi. Gamma 7 by 2 is going to be 5 by 2. 3 by 2 half root pi divided by 2 into 5 factorial. Okay, pretty simple. Okay, so I'm sure you can cancel a lot of term. This 5 factorial, you can write it as 120. Okay, so on the numerator, you have 3 into 3 into 5 pi. By denominator, you have 2 to the power 5 into 2 into 120. So this will go by a factor of 8, I'm sure. correct? So your answer is 3 pi by 2 to the power of 9. That is nothing but 3 pi by 512. Done. See, it becomes so easy. No need to use any trigonometry, no need to use any complex number approach or trigonometric ratios and identities, any substitution, nothing is required. I know it is a very special tool that you have at hand, but this is only to enable you to save a time. Please don't use this in your school exams. Don't start writing gamma function and all in your school papers, please. Okay, next one. First, so 2 means 2 plus 1 by gamma 3 by 2. This means gamma 4 by 2, which is gamma 2 by 2 gamma. Sum of these will be again 7 by 2. Correct. So gamma root 3 by 2 is going to be half gamma half, which is root pi. Gamma 2 is 1, so leave it. This will be 2 into, this is going to be 5 by 2, 3 by 2, half gamma half. So this and this gets cancelled. So your answer will be nothing but 2 by 15. Done. Last one, you will solve it, guys. I've solved a lot of them. Please solve the last one and type your response. I would not move forward till I get answer from at least 3 of you. Okay, Shreya says 1 by 12.
The 1 by 24 I got.
1 by 24, okay. Shreya has also changed.
Well, I got 1 by 24.
1 by 24. Hamsini, Samyukta, Rutu, Ardara, Rashmi. Malikhit also 1 by 24. Okay, let's discuss this. This is gamma 5 plus 1 by 2, which is 3, 3 plus 1 by 2, which is 2, by 2 gamma 5. So answer is going to be 2 into 1 by 2. This is 24 gone, 1 by 24 done. That doesn't even take me 5 seconds if I know these gamma functions. Awesome. So now we are going to move on to the last leg of this chapter, which is expressing definite integral as limit of a sum. Now, this definition actually comes from your geometrical understanding of definite integrals. So many of the books will do this part little early in the chapter. But I decided to do it in the end because I can club this with a limit of a sum as definite integral. So we'll go in both directions. We'll do definite integral as limit of a sum and limit of a sum as definite integral. Fine. So the meaning of integral f of x from a to b is what? It is like finding the area under the function f of x from a to b, right? So this is your graph, let's say. And you're integrating from x equal to a till x equal to b. Okay, so how do you integrate this geometrically? You choose a strip, thin strip. You choose a very thin strip of width dx at a distance of x apart. Yes or no? Correct. Thickness is dx. Okay, height is f of x. So area of this strip or differential area of this infinitesimally thin strip is going to be f of x into dx, correct? And if you integrate it from a to b, you end up getting your area under this curve, okay? Now the same thing I'll do manually. Okay, not by taking a dx, but by taking a width of thickness h, h tending to zero. Okay, so what I'll do is, I'll start with a very thin strip right in the beginning over here. Let's say this strip. Okay, this is a rectangular strip whose height is f of a and thickness is h. Correct? So the area of that small strip, let me call this as strip number one, is going to be what? Strip number one area is going to be fa into h, or you can say h into f of a. If I make a second strip over here, okay, remember now, the height of this strip will be a plus h and thickness is still h. So this will give me the area of the second strip. Correct? If I keep doing this till I reach my nth strip over here, please note that this is my nth strip. Now what is n here? N here is a infinitely big quantity. That means you are breaking this area into very thin strips, but those number of strips are infinitely many. It's like the thread in your cloth. Okay, there are infinitely many threads, and each thread is almost of thickness zero, right, which results into the area of that cloth, isn't it? So in the same way, these rectangular strips are like those threads in that cloth, and there are infinitely many of them, and each of these thread is almost tending to zero thickness. So h is tending to zero. Correct? So who will tell me what is the area of the nth strip that I'm going to find out? It's going to be h into f of a plus n minus 1 h. Yes or no? So if I add all of them, can I say I'll end up getting my integral of f of x from a to b? Correct? And on the right hand side, if I take the h term common, it will be f of a plus h, f of a plus 2h, and so on till f of a plus n minus 1h. Remember here, h is tending to 0, n is tending to infinity. Okay, now something very interesting, guys. Since this is a, okay, this is a plus h, this is a plus 2h, this is a plus n minus 1h, and b is actually a plus nh. Okay, so there's a very important finding here. B is actually a plus nh, which means nh is nothing but b minus a. Now this expression is quite surprising because n is infinity, h is tending to zero. So you're trying to say 0 minus infinity is a fixed number. Yes, of course it can happen because it's an indeterminate form. It is an indeterminate form. Correct? So here, one more thing I would like to add. Instead of writing n tending to infinity, I will basically write nh is equal to b minus a. Because I don't want two limits variable to be involved unnecessarily. This expression is called finding the limit, finding definite integral as limit of a sum, or also called finding the definite integral through first principles. Okay. Now, before I even give you the first problem to solve on this, there are some important results which we need to remember. I'm sure you would all remember that, but I just want to reiterate it. Okay, in case you have forgotten it, okay. First result, summation of all natural numbers from 1 to n. What is it? Correct. Summation of square of
n plus 1.
Yeah, summation of square of all natural numbers from 1 to n. This would be used. That's why I'm giving you these results. So you must be wondering how come I started talking about progressions all of a sudden. They are the prerequisites. They would be required while solving definite integral as limit of a sum, because ultimately you are summing, correct? And when you're summing, you need summation results. Apart from this, sine series. Sine series is where you are having sine of angles which are in AP? So let's say you are summing this. Note down this result, sine n beta by 2 this 2 is only below n minus 1 and beta, okay, not next to alpha. Please note this down. Next, cosine series also. Only difference from sine series is there is a cos term coming over here. So this sine is replaced by a cos. Rest everything is ditto the same. Okay, so don't forget these formulas. Yeah, and apart from that, you should know your standard limits also, right? So limit of e to the power x minus 1 by x as x tends to 0 is 1. Okay, limit of sine x by x extending to 0 is 1. Okay, let's take questions on this. Yeah, NCERT problem. Evaluate e to the power x integral from a to b using limit of sum. Done? Once you're done, please type done. Okay. Anybody else? Shreya says done. Anybody else? Okay, so it's very simple. So integral from a to b, e to the power x dx, you can write it as limit h tending to 0, and your nh, wherever it appears, you have to put a b minus a. So it goes like this: h f of a would be e to the power a, f of a plus h will be e to the power a plus h, f of a plus 2h will be e to the power a plus 2h, and it goes all the way till e to the power a plus n minus 1h. Okay, if you see here, it's a GP. Okay, it's a GP whose first term is e to the power a and common ratio is e to the power h. So we all know the GP formula. That's the first term, the common ratio to the power of n, which is e to the power nh minus 1 by common ratio minus 1. Now, wherever you see an NH, let's quickly place a B minus A there. So it becomes something like this. Right? Now, what about this term? H by e to the power h minus 1 as h tends to 0, right? It's just the reciprocal of that standard exponential limits which I gave you a little while ago. So e to the power x minus 1 by x as x tends to 0 is 1. So is h by e to the power h minus 1, h tending to 0. So this is going to be 1 e to the power a, e to the power, which is nothing but e to the power b minus e to the power a. And we all know that this is the result when you integrate e to the power x from a to b, right? It's nothing but e to the power x, put upper limit minus lower limit. Okay, so this is what we got from the limit of a sum expression as well. Is this clear, guys? Is the approach clear? Please don't make any mistake in, you know, writing the formulae. Secondly, note that wherever an nh comes, you have to put a b minus a there. Right, so there's a small rule of thumb which I'll tell you. Whenever you see an NH expression, okay, where a complete pair of N and H is getting formed, don't hesitate to put a B minus A there. But wherever there's an H alone, wherever there's an H alone, there's no N to pair up with it, then you put that H as 0 or evaluate the limit of H tending to 0 as the case may be. Let's take this question. Evaluate integral of sine x from a to b using limit of a sum. Just type done once you're done. Share is on.
Yes, sir, done.
Done? Okay, chalo, let's discuss this. So again, the same integral from a to b sine of x. You can write it as limit h tending to 0 and nh equal to b minus a. H times f of a. F of a would be sine a. Sine a plus h. Sine a plus 2h. All the way till sine a plus n minus 1h. Okay. Now here we can use our sine series. So your alpha is a, beta is h. So sine n h by 2 by sine h by 2 sine a plus n minus 1 h by 2. Okay. Now, as I told you, wherever you see an NH, put a B minus A immediately. So this NH, I can put a B minus A by 2. Sine H by 2 will remain sine H by 2. Sine, this you can write it as A. This term here, I'm just writing it down here. It's NH minus H by 2, which is nothing but B minus A minus 0 by 2. Correct. So this entire term is B minus A by 2. Any doubts so far? All these steps are clear. So this becomes sine of a plus b by 2. Okay. And what I'm going to do here is, in order to neutralize this, I'm going to put a 2 and a 2 over here. It says that sine h by 2 by h by 2, or reciprocal of this, becomes 1. So your final answer looks like this: sine b minus a by 2 into sine b plus a by 2. Okay. Now let us use our transformation formula. We all know that 2 sine a cos b is nothing but cos a minus b minus cos, I'm sorry, sine b. Yeah, 2 cos a minus b cos a plus b. So it's going to be cos a minus b is going to give you an a, and a plus b is going to give you a b. So it's just cos a minus cos b. That's going to be your answer. Please note, when you have been asked to do it by limit of a sum, please directly do not integrate it. You will get 0 marks in your exam. Okay? Because see, it becomes a super easy problem if you're using your direct formula. But that is not what is the purpose of the problem. The purpose of the problem is whether you know how to write it as a limit of a sum. So in your exam, if it is mentioned, write it as a limit of a sum. Do not directly write the formula and do it. You will not get any marks. Okay. Don't even expect some grace marks to be given to you. Let's take this question. Evaluate dx by under root of x from a to b. Any idea how to do this? This problem is slightly different from what we did in the previous two problems. Okay. And by this time you would have realized that because there is no way you can actually sum this up by using your regular summation series. Okay. So basically, when you write this as a limit of a sum, what do you end up writing? You write something like this, limit h tending to zero. Okay. And nh is b minus a. And the expression that you write is h f of a. F of a is 1 by root a. Then f of a plus h. F of under root a plus 2h. And so on till. Correct? Now how do you sum this up? That is the problem. How do I sum this up? Any idea, anyone? Okay. Who was that? All right. In order to do this, I would like to recall for you sandwich theorem. How many of you remember sandwich theorem?
That's how you get that sin x by x thing, no?
Yes, exactly. In sandwich theorem, if you are able to, let's say there are three functions, gx, fx, and hx. You know that this function f of x is sandwiched between these two guys in the neighborhood of x equal to a. Okay, if you know this, that your f of x is sandwiched between g of x and h of x. As x tends to near the neighborhood of x equal to a. And you know that the limit of g of x as x tends to a is L, and limit of h of x as x tends to a is also L. Then the limit of the sandwich function f of x as x tends to a, this will also be L without actually evaluating it. Now you must be wondering, how am I planning to use this to solve this limit? Okay, so all of you please focus on this approach. So I'll come back to this page. I'll just go to the next page because I need a lot of space to write. Consider my following argument. If you see each of these terms were of the nature 1 by root r, correct? each of these terms was of the nature 1 by root r, right? 1 by root a, 1 by root a plus h, 1 by root a plus 2h, etc. They were of the nature 1 by root r. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to multiply and divide with this numerator and denominator by a 2. So 2 here, 2 here. Okay. Can I say this term would always be greater than or equal to 2 by under root r plus h plus root r? Please note, h is a very small quantity, but nevertheless, this denominator is heavier than this denominator. So if a denominator is heavy, the entire value comes a little down, comes a little less, right? In the same way, can I say this term would slightly be lesser than 2 by root of r minus h plus root r? Now here your denominator is slightly lighter than this root, this 2 root r. See, this quantity is lesser than 2 root r. And this quantity is greater than 2 root r. So when your denominator is heavier, the overall expression drops down. When your denominator is lighter, overall expression slightly becomes more. Right? So far, so good. Any problem in understanding these two? Clear. Please write CLR if it is clear.
Clear, sir.
Clear? Only one person has written clear. 2% has written. Okay, everybody is writing now. Fine. Now, how do I plan to use this? Let me rationalize it. So if I rationalize it, do you all recall that it will become a root r plus h minus root r by h? Okay, here also I'm dropping the 2 factor. Here also, if I rationalize it, it becomes by minus h. Okay, can I just reverse the position of these two? Can I just swap the position of these two and get this negative sign out of the picture? So let me do that. Okay. Is that clear? Okay. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to bring this h up. I'm going to multiply throughout with h. Is that fine? Now start putting the value of r as 1 by a. So let's say I put r as a. Okay. So this will become 2 under root a plus h minus root a. This will become 2 under root a minus under root a minus h. Okay, then put your value as a plus h. So here it will become a plus 2h minus a plus h. Here it will become 2 under root a plus h minus root a. Okay, keep on doing this till you reach h by under root a plus n minus 1h. So this expression will be 2 times under root a plus nh minus under root a plus n minus 1h. Whereas this side will become under root a plus n minus 1h minus under root a plus n minus 2h. Any doubts so far? Okay. Let us add them. On the middle side of this expression, you will get h times 1 by root a, 1 by root a plus h, till 1 by root a plus n minus 1h. This is actually our expression that we required, correct? I'll go back to the previous board and show you this was the expression that we were actually looking for. Whereas this side, you will see cancellation of terms will happen, right? Ultimately leaving you with under root of a plus nh minus root a. Okay. This side, what will happen? Again, cancellation of terms will happen. Okay. Leaving you with this term minus this. Understood. So treat as if this was your function and this was sandwiched between h of x and g of x. Okay. You want to find the limit of this guy. Correct. We want to find the limit of this guy. So let us see what is the limit of h of x as h tends to 0. So let's find out limit of 2 under root of a plus. By the way, nh is b minus a. So you just write a b minus a. Okay. This will become a very simple case. It will become 2 root b because a and a will get cancelled minus root a. This, let's find out the limit of this. I'll write it in yellow. Here also same thing. A plus NH minus H. H is 0, so I'll put A. So again here, H, NH you can put, this NH you can put as B minus A. And this H alone is 0. And this is root A. So A and A gets cancelled. Ultimately, you get the same expression back. Okay. So it means that both the sandwiching functions are tending to 2 root B minus A. So the sandwiched function will also become 2 root B minus A. So this limit here, I'm going back to the previous problem. This limit here is going to be 2 under root of B minus root A. Which is obvious because we know from our formula that 1 by root x dx from a to b gives you two root x from b to a, which is nothing but 2 root b minus 2 root a. That is 2 times root b minus root a. Is this clear, guys? Any question? So this is the use of sandwich theorem that probably you would have done last year. Okay. So directly use of summation is not helping us. So we have to fall back on sandwich theorem to do this. Any questions? Please type no questions if you don't have any questions.
Sir, no questions.
No questions.
No questions.
Okay. Now we'll be talking about the reverse process. Limit of a sum as definite integral. So this is the reverse of the process that we just now did. So in the previous process, what did we do? We converted definite integral to a limit of a sum. Now we are converting limit of a sum as definite integrals. So there are a lot of limits question. I don't know whether you have come across them or not, where the limit is of the form or indeterminacy is of the form 0 into infinity. And you are not able to apply any standard summation process. Neither are you able to apply any standard limits to solve them. Okay. How to deal with those kind of problems? That is what we are going to study in this particular part. Now, I would try to explain this to you by taking a simple example. Okay. I'll try to take an example to explain this concept to you. Let me just pull out an example for it, suitable example, so that this thing is clear in your mind. Yeah, let's say we want to evaluate limit as n tends to infinity, 1 by n square, 2 by n square, 3 by n square, all the way till let's say 1 by n. By the way, 1 by n is nothing but n by n square. It's a short form of writing it. How do you evaluate this? Now here, you would say, sir, it's very simple. I would just, now how many of you think that the answer to this would be obtained by using this approach? This is zero because n is very big, n is infinity. This is zero, this is zero, everything is zero. So your answer will be zero. How many of you think this?
I don't think that, sir.
Of course not, sir.
Of course not, and you should not also think like that, because let me tell you, if you're thinking like this, then there's a very big conceptual error that you are making. Here, each of these quantities is tending to zero. Okay. Who wrote that? No.
Likhit.
Oh, Likhit is controlling.
Yes, the Likhit.
How can Likhit is...
He's an artist. He's an artist. Ask Dheeraj, sir. So he's an artist.
Likhit, how did you get the control of my desktop?
So even we can do that. So like all of us can do it.
But I have to make you the presenter, right?
No, sir.
I didn't do that, sir.
Okay. Never mind. See, each of these quantities is tending to zero, right? But there are infinitely many of them, right? So you cannot underestimate a small quantity which are present infinitely many number of times. It's like a drop of water. A small drop of water present infinitely many number of times can give you an ocean also. Correct. So never think that they are equal to zero. They are tending to zero here. The entire idea is this is actually an indeterminate form. An indeterminate form can take a lot of values. Okay. But here you would say, sir, I don't need a definite integral to solve it, because even if you don't allow me to do that, which actually should not be used, let's say this method is ruled out, I can actually sum this up, right? 1 plus 2 plus 3 all the way till n by n square, correct? And we can evaluate this limit by using our formula of summation of natural numbers from 1 to n. Okay. And what do we do next? We divide by n throughout. So it becomes 1 plus 1 by n by 2. And as n tends to infinity, this term will become 0. So the answer is half actually, not 0. Fine. Now, there's another approach that we normally take. Here it works fine, but there are so many questions which I'm going to give you next where your summation will fail. But since I've taken this as an example to explain how limit of a sum can be converted to a definite integrals, okay, let me explain you something very interesting. So here, let me go by algorithm so that you follow that algorithm to solve all the problem. The first step of the algorithm is identify the rth term of this series. Who will tell me what is the rth term? Jaldi batao. This is the first term, this is the second term, this is the third term, this is the nth term. So what is the rth term?
R by r square.
R by n square.
Oh yeah, n.
Correct. Step number two. From your rth term, pull out a 1 by n common, always, always. So write it like this. Understood? So what is the second step? From your rth term, pull a 1 by n out. Always, in whatever problem that you're going to come across, this step is mandatory. Right? Step number three. Put your r by n as x, or replace your r by n term with an x and 1 by n term with a dx. Correct. So what happens? Tr becomes what in this case? X dx. Okay. Now what are you doing? You're trying to find out summation of tr, right? From r equal to 1 till n, and n is tending to infinity. This is what we're trying to do. Correct. Now this term would be replaced by an integration sign, because summation is actually an integration process. Or vice versa. Okay. where limit of integration is decided by from which r to which r you are summing up. Now see here, in this present question, all of you would have understood by now that you are summing from r equal to 1. So this summation is from, I can write it like this, this summation is from r equal to 1 till n, correct? And you are trying to sum this term, okay, where n is tending to infinity, isn't it? So now here you have claimed your x to be r by n. See here, you have claimed your x to be r by n. So this will help you to decide the limit of integration. How? That we'll see in step number 4. In step number 4, which is the step of deciding the limits, when your r is 1, let me write it like this. When your r is 1, x is equal to 1 by n, which is nothing but 0. And when your r becomes n, x will become n by n, which is nothing but 1. So this will become your lower and the upper limit of integration. So this is your lower limit of integration, and this is your upper limit of integration. Okay. So ultimately what I'm asking you to do is, I'm asking you to convert this entire problem. I'll go back on top here. I'm going to ask you to convert this entire problem to integration from 0 to 1. This is your x, this is your dx, and that's your answer. So which we know that it's x square by 2, put your upper and the lower limit, is going to be half. The same answer that we got over here. Are the steps clear to you?
So, yes, sir.
I'll repeat once again. Write down the rth term. Okay. Pull out a 1 by n from the rth term. Put r by n as x. Put 1 by x, 1 by n as dx. Now, depending from which r to which r you are integrating, or what are your limits on r, since your r is x by n, sorry, since your x is r by n, you can find your x accordingly. Anybody has any doubt? If you have no doubt, I'm going to give you the next question. In fact, I'm going to give you at least 5-10 questions on this concept, because this is very important. Find limit n tending to infinity 1 by n plus 1, 1 by n plus 2, 1 by n plus 3, all the way till 1 by 2n. Done. Anyone any idea how to do it? How many of you are trying?
Trying.
So here, follow the steps which I told you. Step number one, write down the Rth term. I'm sure you would have all written this Rth term correctly. Correct? Step number two, take 1 by n common from the Rth term. Correct. Now, try to convert this as a function of R by N. Okay. Try to write this as a function of R by N. That means I should see only constants in R by N terms here. So divide by N throughout. So it will become 1 plus R by N. So here, this is your function of R by N. Guys, this is a very critical step. So 1 by n after you have taken out, whatever is left, write that as a function of R by n. Because ultimately you have to put R by n as your x, isn't it? Okay. Now, so this becomes 1 by 1 plus x, because you have to replace your R by n with an x, replace 1 by n with a dx. On that replacement, you will get 1 by 1, this is 1, by 1 plus this is your x. This entire term is your x. Okay. And this term will become your dx. Now, what about the limits of integration? If you see, you're integrating from r equal to 1. By the way, this term is n plus n. So you're integrating from r equal to 1 till n. Okay. So when your r is 1, x will be 0. So this will be 0. And when your r is n, x will be 1. So this will be 1. So your problem boils down to solving this definite integral, which we all know is ln 1 plus x. Put the limits of integration, it becomes ln 2 minus ln 1, which is nothing but ln 2. So the summation of this, or the value of this limit, is nothing but ln 2. Guys, let me tell you, without the use of definite integrals, it would be almost impossible to evaluate such kind of limits, right? And especially the ones of the type 0 into infinity. So whenever these kind of limit problems are, you know, found out in your questions, keep the options alive that you can use your definite integral also to solve it. Okay. First try your normal approach. First try your formula. First try your summation. If it works, then well and good. If it doesn't, then there is possibility of using definite integrals there. And just follow these steps. Are you finding these steps difficult to follow? I don't think so. Let me ask you another one. So we'll have a lot of practice. Till you are confident about it, we'll keep having problems after problems. So let's say limit n tending to infinity. N by n square plus 1 square. N by n square plus 2 square, and so on till n by 2n square. This time everybody should solve it. I'm giving you 3 to 4 minutes to solve it. I'm sure you can all do it. Thank you.
Sir, I'm getting pi by 4.
Pi by 4, okay.
Pi by 4.
Pi by 4. Anybody else? Yes, who wants?
Even I got pi by 4.
Pi by 4. Pi by 4, oh. Let me tell you, is the right answer. Very good. Step number 1.
Nice, bro, Paras.
Step number 1, write down the nth term. Sorry, rth term. Okay. Step number 2, pull out a 1 by n common. So it'll leave you with n square by n square plus r square. Now you have to convert the remaining part, which is after taking 1 by n, whatever is remaining part, you have to convert it as a function of r by n only. Right now it is not in that shape. So I have to bring it to that shape by taking n square in the denominator. So it becomes 1 by 1 plus r square by n square. Which is like saying this. Okay. Now, step number 3. Role change. Wherever there is a 1 by n, put a dx. Wherever there is an rn, put by x. So it becomes 1 by 1 plus x square. Correct? What about the limits of integration? See here, r is going from 1 till n. If r is going from 1 till n, remember x is r by n. So when r is 1, x is 0. When r is n, x is 1. So limit of integration is 0 to 1. Okay. So isn't it integration of tan inverse x from 0 to 1, which is pi by 4? Absolutely correct. Awesome. Yeah, let's solve this. See, basically this series goes like this. Okay, next term is 1 by n plus 2, n plus 4. Next term is 1 by n plus 3, n plus 6, and so on. That's why it, towards the end it becomes n plus n and n plus 2n. That's nothing but 2n into 3n, which is nothing but 6n square. That's how this 6n square over here comes up. Okay, so this is the way it, in which it is moving on. Done. What is the answer? People have done, please type in the answer.
Oh, I forgot to substitute.
Sir, I'm getting a very weird answer. It's like okay. I can't type it.
Can you send me the photograph?
Yeah, 1 minute.
Sure. Two pi by 6√3. Okay.
Yes, sir, I've sent it.
Okay. The book answer is log of 3/2. Please note there's a n also waiting outside here. This n. So if I asked you step number one, tell me the rth term. What will you say? N by n plus r, n plus 2r. Correct. Step number two. Well, let me check. Oh, yeah, yeah. See, I think it could be further simplified. Had you used partial fractions, it would have been much better. Okay, step number two. Take a 1 by n out. So it becomes n square by n plus r, n plus 2r. Okay. Now here an important part is you need to express this as a function of r by n. This you need to express as a function of r by n. Okay. So divide by n square. But when you divide by n square, you give 1 n to this. So divide this by n square, divide this by n, and divide this by n. So it becomes 1 plus r by n, 1 plus 2 r by n. Okay. Now, replacement. Let's replace 1 by n with dx, r by n with x. Okay. So it becomes 1 by 1 plus x, 1 plus 2x, dx. Limit of integration will be again 0 to 1 because your r is from 1 to n. So ultimately you are evaluating this definite integral. So 1 by 1 plus x, you can break it up as partial fractions. 1 by 1 plus x plus b by 1 plus 2x. Okay. In fact, this can be compared to 1. Put x value as minus half. This will become b by 2. So b is equal to 2. Put x value as minus 1. Okay, so a value is minus 1. So this could be written as minus of 1 plus x. B value is 2. Okay. Now, integration of dx by 1 plus x, 1 plus 2x is as good as integration of this term. Okay. Limit of integration 0 to 1. So minus ln 1 plus x, 0 to 1, 2 by 2 ln 1 plus 2x, 0 to 1. So this will become minus ln 2, and this will become ln 3 minus ln 1, which is actually 0. So the answer is ln of 3 by 2. Okay, so once you know your denominator is factorizable, the better approach would have been to convert it as a partial fraction problem and then do it. Is that fine, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Just type
yes, fine. Sir.
Everybody just type fine if it is fine. Not clear, Samyukta, fine. F9, fine. Fine. Okay. Simple one. Limit n tending to infinity, 1 by na, 1 by na plus 1, 1 by na plus 2, all the way till 1 by nb. Samyukta has written fine factorial. Who is on this?
Sir, I did it, sir.
For vectors, I'll send you some videos. Please do watch it. Okay. Done. What is the answer, Shreya?
I got ln of 1 by a plus 1.
Come again. Ln of
1 by a plus 1.
Ln of 1 by a plus 1. That's actually 1 minus ln a, right?
Yeah.
There's no b in the answer, but there's a b in the question.
I'll try.
Yeah, check your working once again.
Oh, okay. I got my mistake, sir. 2 minutes.
Yeah.
So I'm not getting what the upper limit would be.
Why not? See, let's go step by step. Step number one. Rn term would be what? See, it doesn't matter. Even if you start with zero, it doesn't matter. So let's say Na plus R. R starts from zero all the way till, okay. Now, what is the last step? When you say Na plus R becomes Nb, that means R is NB minus A, right? So your R is going from 0 to NB minus A. This is very important. Okay. Meanwhile, let me complete step number 2. Pull out N, so it becomes N by NA plus R, which you write it as 1 by N. 1 by a plus r by n. This everybody would have got it. Any doubt so far? Okay. Now, step number three. Replace 1 by n with dx. Replace r by n with x. Okay. Now, limits of integration also, I will write it as a and b. Okay. So, a is nothing but 0 by n, which is 0. Okay. I should not write a and b here, actually. Let me write upper and the lower limit, because b is already used and a is already used in the question. So, upper and the lower limit. Sorry, lower and the upper limit. Yeah. Upper limit will be what? R by n, and you're putting R as n b minus a. So n b minus a by n. So upper limit will be b minus a. Getting the point? Paras?
Yes, sir, I got it.
Now got it. So basically, your entire expression gets converted to dx 1 by a plus x integral from 0 to b minus a, which is nothing but ln of a plus x, put the upper limit b minus a, lower limit 0. So upper limit will give you ln b, lower limit will give you ln a, so it's ln of b by a.
Got it.
Is that fine? So if you have any problem understanding how do we evaluate upper and the lower limit, let me tell you, once you have put your x as r by n, you just have to put r as the initial value of the summation and r as the final value of the summation, and then you have to check your upper and lower limit. Please try this. Hint is, first take log. Any idea, anyone?
Yes, sir, solving.
Right.
If I want to include this N within this bracket, can I say it will come inside as N to the power N? If I want to put this 1 by N as a power on the entire expression. Okay, let's say I call this limit as N. So basically you can give one N to each one of them. Take log. Because ultimately we have to convert it as a process of summation, isn't it? So log of this, I can individually write it as log 1 plus 1 by n, log 1 plus 2 by n, log 1 plus 3 by n, and so on till log of 1 plus 1 by 1, which is, you can say, n by n. Now from here onwards, you start applying your normal steps. Find out the r term. Take a 1 by n common. I think 1 by n is already taken out common because by our problem itself, 1 by n is outside. So step 1, write down the r-th term. R-th term is 1 by n log 1 plus r by n. Now you can do it, I think. Complete it and tell me the answer. Step 2, replace 1 by n with dx, r by n with x. Limit of integration would be, a would be 0, b would be n by n, which is 1. So it's 0 to 1 log 1 plus x dx. Now to evaluate this, we have to use integration by parts. But we already know the result of log x. Minus 1. No. So we already know how to integrate log x, correct? Log x integration is x log x minus 1, correct? Same way this will be 1 plus x log 1 plus x minus 1. Put your limits of integration. So when you put a 1, you get 2 log 2 minus 1. And when you put a 0, it becomes 0. Sorry, it becomes 1 log 1 minus 1, which is nothing but 2 log 2 minus 2. And this will give you a 0 plus 1. So answer is 2 log 2 minus 1, which is log 4 minus 1, which is actually log 4 by e. Okay, but remember, this is the answer for log of the limit. So log of the limit is log 4 by e. So L is 4 by e. Is that clear? Next.
Sir, is that an error in the question, the 3 cube thing?
Yeah, this is square. That's a typo. Now the problem is, even if you know the result for these two, okay, we are not aware of the result for this right now. Neither do we have the time to actually find that result out. So don't try to attempt this question by the use of your special summations that you have learned. See, basically you are doing summation r square, okay, and this is summation r cube. And this is summation r to the power 6. Let me do one thing. Let me multiply this with an n square and provide this with a summation of n square. And okay, now let's divide throughout with n to the power 6. If you divide by n to the power 6, it will give me 1 by n.
Sorry, this term will not be there. Correct. Now, since these two terms are falling short of a 1 by n, so I'll introduce a 1 by n, 1 by n here. Correct. Now, limit has a property that you can take the limit individually in all the terms. So this into this. Divided by this. Okay. So this appears to be your dx and this is x square. So it is integral of x square dx. Okay. This is nothing but integral of x cube dx. This is integral of x to the power 6 dx. I'm sure limit of integration, you would all have figured out it's 0 to 1. Okay. So this answer is 1/3. This answer is 1/4. This answer is 1/7. Okay, so the answer is 7 by 12. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, I would like to end this chapter with a small test for you all. Okay, so I'll give you a question. Okay. You guys need to solve it and tell me the response before it is 5 o'clock. Okay. Yeah. So the question goes like this. First online test. The question goes like this. If you have a function which satisfies this functional equation, okay, find the function. Any idea, guys?
So last 40 seconds.
Oh, okay.
No, sir, don't know.
Good try. Others, anybody who could find success? Okay, just see here carefully. If you just split open this, okay, the answer is hidden in the question itself. If you split this up, it becomes, since you're integrating with respect to y, x is just like a constant. So x 0 to 1 y square f y dy and x square y f y dy. So what I've done is this term, I've just opened it up. Clear? Now, anyways, this is going to be a constant, isn't it? Let's say I call it as A. This is also going to be a constant. Let me call it as B. Okay. That means what I'll do now, I'll take an X common here so that it makes my life easy. Because X is here also, X is here also. So I'll take an X common. Okay. Now this entire thing is a constant. Let me call it as A. Which actually tells you that your function is of this nature, ax plus b, isn't it? Ax plus b x square, correct? Getting my point, are you convinced till this stage? Are you happy till this stage?
Yeah. Convinced. So,
see, when you integrate something and you put the limits of integration, ultimately that gives you a number, right? That gives you a constant. So what I'm saying is that 1 plus this constant is another constant. So overall, the structure of your function is just like a constant into x and b into x square. Okay. Now, how do I get this a and how do I get this b? That's a different thing. So let's just try to find them out. Now, what is a itself? A itself is 1 plus integration 0 to 1 y square fy. Now fx is this, so can I say fy will be ay plus by square? See, if this is your fx, fy will be what? Just change the name of the variable from x to y, isn't it? Now this is something which you can easily integrate. So 1 plus ay square integration will be ay to the power 4 by 4 by to the power 5 by 5. Okay, put 0 to 1, it becomes 1 plus a by 4 plus b by 5. So this is your A. So first equation I got. Correct? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now what is B itself? B itself is, let me just increase the light. Yeah, B itself is integration of y fy. Fy is again ay plus by square. Okay, from 0 to 1. So ay square is ay cube by 3. And ay cube is by 4 by 4 from 0 to 1.
So that means nothing but a by 3 plus b by 4. So second equation that you end up getting is b itself is a by 3 plus b by 4. This will help us to get the value, let me call it as 1 and 2. From 1 and 2, we can get the value of a and b, and we can substitute it back over here, as you can see. Okay, so let's solve the second one first. So 3b by 4 is equal to a by 3. That means b is 4a by 9. Okay, put it in the first one. So a, you can write this as 3a by 4. Is equal to 1 plus b by 5. B by 5 will be 4a by 45. Correct. So take the a's together. So 3 by 4 minus 4 by 45 is equal to 1. So this is going to be 135 minus 20 by 180. Is a. Okay. So a is equal to 180 by 115. Correct. So 119. Okay. So what is b itself? B will be 4a by 9. 4a by 9. 4 by 9, 180 by 119. This is 20, so this is 80 by 119. So your function is, as you can see, your function is ax plus bx squared. So ax means 180 by 119x plus bx square is 80 by 119x square. Okay. So guys, this is end of definite integrals. Okay. But subject to more practice from your end. With respect to vectors, I'll send you a video. So you watch that video. I think vector that you have for your semester exam is pretty easy. You'll have just a dot product and cross product and all, which you've already done in physics. A little bit of collinearity and coplanarity concepts that you need to understand. For that, I'll send you a video. You can watch it. Okay. So thank you so much. Over and out from my side. Bye-bye. Have a good day. Who is that? I was about to save that. Okay, guys. Chalo, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, sir.